Warmly welcome our professor madam Dr. Lalita Ramakrishnan garu from School of Management Studies, Pondicherry University. Madam is an advisor to the department and a well-wisher of our MBA department. She's like a guide for me, mentor for me. Now I welcome ma'am to present her class. Now before presenting ma'am's class, I just ask Vani of our MBA class to present a brief profile of our today's resource person. I just hand over to Vani of MBA previous.
Dr. Masar, the host has disabled the screen share. Please ask them to enable the screen share. I can't share my slides. Please tell your host.
Okay, ma'am, I'll ask you. Enable
the slide share. Yeah, screen share. Please.
Okay, madam.
Good evening to one and all. Myself, M. Vani, first MBA. It's my privilege to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Lalita Ramakrishnan garu, professor, Pondicherry University, Pondicherry. She has many qualifications to credit. She has graduated with BA degree in 1986. Done MBA with marketing specialization in 1988 and obtained PhD from research title A Study of Social Involvement in Oil Refinery Industry in the year 1995 from Sri Venkateshwara University. She has 25 years of teaching experience with excellence knowledge of the subject and proficiency in the giving capture knowledge. She also handled key responsibilities like published papers both in national and international journals and author about 20 business and management related books, attended for more than 30 national and international seminars, workshops and faculty development programs. She also delivered the e-lectures for many institutions. Professor won national award for best seller presentation and best teacher award in regional and national wide. This is a very impressive profile about today's speaker. Thank you.
With this brief profile, I request ma'am to present her session to take over the proceedings.
Thank you, Ms. Vani and Dr. Mazhar. Good evening to all of you. I have a weakness when KBN College Management or Dr. Mazhar asked me for a talk, I can never say no. KBN College is almost like my parental home. I find it very difficult to say no. That is why yesterday late evening when Dr. Mazhar called me that I need to take a class for the students, I couldn't say no. So this is, I hope that my slides are to all of you. There is no power here. So are my slides visible? Yes?
Yes, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now this is a talk on strategic management. See, we all belong to the, especially teachers like me, senior teachers, we belong to the chalk and talk generation. That is a generation. Kindly excuse me, I'll switch off the fan because I think it is noisy. Is my voice better now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. So teachers like me who belong to the chalk and talk generation, if there is a blackboard and a chalk, we are comfortable teaching. Have slowly got into teaching with PowerPoint, use of technology, you know, multimedia presentations, audio visuals and so on. But we never knew what is a Zoom and how to use, you know, Skype or Adobe or Apache or, you know, GoToMeeting or Apache Open Meeting, Google Meet, Microsoft Skype and so on. You know, these are all very much new to us before March 25th, before the lockdown. Today, we have no option but to work on these. And many of us started using these, this as an opportunity to reach the audience in different institutions as well as our own students. So Dr. Mazhar made a request to me to keep my talk for about 45 minutes to 1 hour, and then there will be a question answer session. So you all might have seen that the total number of COVID cases in India have touched 440K now. We are in the fourth position. Within just 1 week, we moved, our ranks have moved from 11th to 4th position in the world. And where are we heading to? You all might be confused. You know, many of my students in the fourth semester have their own worries about their placement offers, and including their parents, some of them are stressed. What is going to be the future of business? And the future of the business is the future of management students as well. So how is that, you know, this COVID is going to end? You all might have seen that, you know, we had pandemics like Ebola or anthrax or, you know, Zika virus, which all subsided in 4 to 6 months. But we really do not know where we, I mean, how, when and how this COVID is going to end. And we are all panicked. We are all hammer struck at home. For the last 3 months, we have not seen our students offline. It's only through our online platforms that we are able to see our students and our colleagues. And all the meetings are taking place in Zoom and, you know, in Skype and all these things. So what is going to happen to us? So as business students, how are we going to utilize these opportunities? And how did the world react during pandemics? If you see this, we'll get an idea about how these consultancy firms like BCG and other firms are predicting what is going to happen to business. See, we are all strategic thinkers because we are from management and we cut across all functional areas of our thinking. And in this context, we need to have a grand plan as to how to go about. And let us see how each sector is working in its own way during this COVID crisis and how, what are their plans for the future. You might have heard of many interesting incidents. You know, car companies like Hyundai are making ventilators. Ayurvedic resorts started making hand sanitizers in Kerala because they don't have now health tourism. And, you know, companies like L'Oreal, which make cosmetics, are today producing, you know, sanitizers. Packaging companies are making face shields. Tourism companies are using GoBoCom cameras. Projecting online, virtual tourism is being promoted. Swiggy is encouraging potluck. They are giving kitchen kits delivered at home. You know, so many innovations. All the cult classes are all online. You know, I have a niece, you know, my sister's grandchild, a six-year-old, learning Bharatanatyam online. You know, she keeps the laptop and she dances when the teacher is teaching her online. So you have everything online today. My son practices his morning exercises in cult online. So see, this has become a day-to-day feature for us. And how long are we going to live with this COVID? Many of the world leaders say, you know, you need to learn to live with COVID. So you need to continuously wear masks and maintain social distancing. And in this context, how are the business houses reacting? Sector after sector, there are gross losses, migrant workers' problems. And, you know, all these issues are cropping up. Let us see what is going to happen to us and what, how business houses are reacting to this COVID crisis. See, in India, the first case was reported on January 28th of COVID. And then the government was a little busy with, you know, their own functioning, defense issues and so on, whatever. But the lockdown was announced only from 25th March 2020. Those countries which have been more alert, like Finland, like New Zealand, especially those countries which have women prime ministers, 5 women prime ministers in the world are there. They have reacted extremely well. They had quarantine centers next to the airports. They did not allow these foreign tourists to enter these cities without quarantining. And these countries escaped with single digit or, you know, double digit COVID cases, and they are now out of danger also. But what is happening to a country like India? You know, for a few weeks, it was a little slow. and you could see, you know, Chennai is you could see is in red zone, a maroon or a brown or black, I don't know what is the situation now in Chennai. About 50,000 cases are there. Even in small places like Pondicherry, where the population is 12 lakhs, the number of COVID cases has gone beyond 300. So we are business people, we are very optimistic. We have seen, we have read about the world history going through influenza crisis, swine flu crisis, and the plague, recurring plague crisis. And we have studied about all these pandemics and the crisis that business has faced. It's really different to all those because, you know, we have a potential to produce vaccine in 1.5 years. In case of plague, it almost took one century to make a medicine for plague. And in case of influenza, they say it is almost 50 years it took. But in our right now in the research, you have Hetero Drugs, which has announced that there is a medicine available. You have Glenmark, which has announced 3 days ago that there is a medicine available. And, you know, you also have the Patanjali Group CEO, Baba Ramdev, announcing that medicine has been launched and clinical trials are over. Of course, you have countries like China, Italy, and Israel claiming that they have developed the vaccines already and the human trials are yet to start. Given this background, let us see what is the situation today in the world. The situation is that, you know, now Mr. Biswal, Assistant Secretary of State for South and Central Asia during the Barack Obama administration, he says, now after the pandemic, I think there's an opportunity here for India. There is an opportunity to build an economy that is more resilient, that is more diversified, and that is more attractive to more global manufacturing and global services. Biswal, who was an Assistant Secretary of State for South and Central Asia during the Barack Obama administration, he said this. And it's because, you know, now the world is going to depend on huge vaccines and also medicines for COVID. And India is a country which has the potential to develop bulk drugs. In fact, Hyderabad is the company. Hyderabad is the city where you have the potential to produce vaccines. You have Shanta Biotech. You have Bharat Biotech. You have the Hetero Drugs. You have one more public sector company at Pune. So these are all some of the places where, you know, we can expect bulk drug manufacturing to take place. But is only pharmaceuticals the answer? How is the scenario? If you see the economic curve, the curve will be V-shaped, U-shaped or L-shaped. In a V-shaped curve, there will be a sudden drop in incomes, gross unemployment, and loss of demand for products. Obviously, reduced supply and production, and no income to the government's exchequer. So it will be, you know, if you see the business cycle curve, if you remember the business cycles that is taught by your managerial economics teacher, the curve will be V-shaped. V-shaped is where there will be deep slump and then sudden raise. The raise will be again picking up of employment, picking up of income levels, you know, picking up of demand and production. And thereby, you know, income to the government exchequer and prosperity. So V-shaped curve is that. In case of U-shaped, there'll be a slump, and there'll be a flat curve, and then it picks up slowly. In case of L-shape, there is a slump, and it doesn't pick up at all. So it takes years and years, maybe 10 years, 20 years, you know. You might have seen, studied about the Great Depression of 1930s. Or the kind of crisis the world has faced after the World War I and World War II. You know, interestingly, you know, during the World Wars II, some companies survived. Especially, you know, a company called Wrigley's, you know, which makes chewing gums, made its best profits, 100 times of profits during World War II because these chewing gums were supplied to the soldiers to reduce their stress levels. So you do not know what are the sectors which are going to, as business people, of course, we can definitely predict which are the sectors which are going to improve during the COVID period and also post-COVID. So in India, there can be a quick rebound, I guess, because we are, you know, business people and we are very optimistic. We would like to turn every problem into an opportunity. So India is a country where we have enthusiastic consumers, less dependence on exports, and government support. Government, of course, now is giving thrust on Make in India and all these things. So let's hope that, you know, our curve is going to be a V curve and not an L curve. And then coming to the opportunities and challenges, you have the FDA, Foreign Direct Investment, and Make in India campaigns. Companies shifting from China is a golden opportunity. The world is not trusting the dragon country. And you all might have seen, you know, the turbulence that is taking place in the Ladakh between the Indian and the Chinese army, and the way our soldiers are losing their lives pathetically. We have a very young, brilliant Lieutenant Colonel from Telangana, you know, Santosh Babuji, who recently lost his life for the country. You might have seen all these things. And, you know, we really do not want to buy any of Chinese products. Indians are boycotting Chinese products. And US-China tariff wars are taking place. Tariff wars are taking place between France and China too. And many of the countries across the world, including Australia, don't want to do business with China. So announcement of incentives to move production from China, out of China, high working age population of India, recent economic reforms, and ease of doing business in India is picking up. If you see the ease of doing business in India, I know it has been picking up very well. So we really feel that, you know, we are going to have a conducive environment, and we are going to become more independent from China. And the challenges that we have is attracting foreign direct investments, because the entire world is in recession now, and alternative sourcing and promoting Buy India campaigns. So all of us should commit ourselves as students of business to buy Indian products, not Chinese products. Next, let us see what are the opportunities. The coronavirus pandemic has influenced foreign firms to shift operations, as I told you. And Japan is also earmarking about 2.2 billion fund to encourage manufacturers just to drive out China. So if you see India's ease of moving, doing business, it has moved up by 14 ranks. Our last year's ease of doing business was 63 out of 190. It has now moved up from 80 to 63 it has moved. So let us see. So how do we create a conducive environment for business? And how do we attract the foreign direct investments? Indian government is repeatedly in the process of identifying and developing 4.6 lakh hectares of land, including 1.1 lakh hectares of existing land in industrial areas, and planning fiscal incentives in the form of preferential tax rates, tax holidays, etc., to attract foreign firms. A few state governments are also proactively working to capitalize on this opportunity. I'm sure the government of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana are also working towards this. And other strategies that we wanted to follow is that, you know, alternative sourcing. And now for over 1,000 items, we are going to replace China as our supplier. And this is going to give a big jolt to China in the economic front. See, I should tell you, during the Second World War in Japan, what has happened is, when the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombing took place, the Japanese government announced to ban US products. It was at that time that, you know, US cars and US electronic items were trying to dominate and sell in Japanese economy. You will not believe, entire Japanese stopped using American products. They have discarded even needles which are made from America. That is the level of patriotism Japan has, and they could rebuild these two cities, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, after the Second World War. What kind of commitment are we going to have in discarding Chinese products? As an Indian, you know, our heart burns when a soldier dies in the borders. And what kind of economic jolt we are going to give to the Chinese economy? It depends on every Indian. So buy Indian like automobiles, electronics, including mobiles. Most of us are using Chinese mobiles, steel, etc. The value, innovation, and economies of scale offered by China are unmatched, no doubt. In view of this, diverting consumers to buy domestic products, which are relatively higher in price, but better value and quality, requires a very serious effort. Let us see how the rural economy is. And the rural economy, due to lockdown, reverse migration is taking place. You might see workers walking back to their villages without food, without water, struggling. In gigantic proportions, the rural economy is going to open up. And there is going to be, you know, marketing of rural products to urban areas, then urban products to rural areas. So rural marketing trend is going to be reversed totally. Coming to the challenge, the COVID-19 points out the need for social distancing and decongesting urban areas. The need to reduce urban population necessitates development of rural economy, of course. State and central governments, through massive spending, unmindful of fiscal deficit, of course, they will definitely, they have already pumped in helicopter money. Helicopter money is printing additional currency notes and distributing during the crisis. Otherwise, you know, temporarily, economists like Bimal Jalan, the former RBI governor, recommend this during this crisis in order to avoid crime. However, after 3 months, there is a scope for crime to pick up, because some other economists are not in favor of this kind of helicopter money, it is called. So state and central governments, unmindful of deficit, they have to spend on agriculture, infrastructure, healthcare, education, and should create rural employment too. This strategy can drive the next wave of economic growth through smart rural economic hubs. Dispersed populations augur well in future calamities like COVID-19. I think you might have read in the papers and online journals that companies like Twitter, when they have permanently announced that there is going to be permanent close down of their brick and cement offices, and 100% in future all their offices will be online, then the employees of Twitter have voluntarily come forward for a wage cut of 20% on their own to work in the rural areas, sitting in with their parents or sitting with their families. They are willing to work anywhere because India is now under 100% satellite coverage. We have no issues of Wi-Fi. Your package must be good enough to support data pack. So otherwise, they are willing to work anywhere. And, imagine the impact of this on the pollution, levels of pollution that is going to drop down in the city, on the fuel consumptions. When COVID was announced, first 2 months, I think most of us enjoyed, the birds chirping, the animals coming out, the pollution-free ambience, the noise-free roads and whatnot. But, day by day, it is almost 5 months since India started suffering. February, March, April, May, June. June is going to come to an end. February, March, April, May, and June is going to come to an end. It's almost 5 months. And now we started worrying about when are we going to get out of this COVID. So let us see how the employment levels are going to, I was telling you about the smart rural hubs and the need to promote local businesses. People are no longer going to huge malls because malls are the, hot spots of COVID spread. So we are again going back to the retailer next to our house and buying rations or groceries or vegetables, whatever we require. So migrant workers and smart rural hubs are the trend. And then what next? How is the rural economy due to lockdown, reverse migration, as I told you, development revolution. And this is the need for social distancing and decongesting of urban areas is required, which is possible. Mahatma Gandhi said, go back to rural areas. But we have all turned back our backs to rural areas. Everybody moved to urban areas. Now again, the rural migration started. The Bhudan Yagna, which Acharya Vinoba Bhave during the freedom struggle has recommended, and the dream of Mahatma Gandhi for Indians to stay in the rural areas, because ours is an agro-based economy. 70% of our population live in villages, and without agriculture, we are going to have food crisis. let the rural be rural and the urban be urban. So the rural migration to rural areas must be embraced as a strategy from the government point of view. And you know, there are other threatening things like Uber lays off 3,500 employees, and you know, TCS has already laid off 25% of their employees, and I know almost all the companies are going for sacking people, asking employees to go on indefinite leave without pay. You know, yesterday I had a phone call from a lady like Dr. Mazur working in Hyderabad, known to me, and she was a scholar of my husband, and she works for a college over there, and she's the principal of the college, and she says for the last 3 months she's not paid, and the Telangana government announced not to insist upon fee payments by the students, because students are affected badly, their income levels of parents are low, and you have helpline numbers, you can make phone calls to the government if anybody insists you to pay the fee. So the private college managements are, you know, in deep crisis, financial crisis. Where from will they get pay? Principal of a college is not being paid for the last 3 months. And in March, they were paid only half the salary, you know, 25% of the salary. Even the state government is paying 50% of the salaries in most of the states. So what is going to be the situation of mental status of this employees? You know, in the US, you know, 40 million jobs are lost already, and 100 million are going to lose their jobs. 100 million is equal to 10 crores. The total population of the US is around 35 crores. So one third are going to be jobless. Same is the situation in India. In India, it is going to be worse because we have a lot of people working in the unorganized sector in India. 85% of our workforce are in unorganized sector. So what is a major challenge as of date? You have companies sacking people, you have job cuts, you have slashing salaries up to 85%, and you know, you need to apply for leave, you need to apply for loss of pay, you need to apply for medical leave to continue with the company if post-COVID it picks up. So in the better worst case scenarios out there, 100 million and more Indian jobs, it is predicted that it can go up to 200 million, are at risk after the COVID-19 lockdown stage. The Confederation of Indian Industry has foreseen job losses in different sectors. Many firms are expected to shed about 30% of their jobs once the lockdown ends also. So pay structure realignment is taking place. Certain organizations are looking to increase the variable component in salaries. The only company which I've seen increasing the salary during this crisis is Asian Paints. They don't want to demotivate their employees, so they have given up a 5% hike in salaries for their employees. On an average, the variable pay ranges from 5 to 10% for entry level in India, 10 to 20% for junior management, experienced individual contributors, 20 to 30% for middle management, and 30 to 50% for, you know, top management, where ex gratia is paid. Depending upon the profits the company earns, the top management is given ex gratia. So across industry sectors, according to a consultancy firm, Chicago-based consultancy firm, which has its branches and our students are working there, Willis Towers Watson. So companies in sectors like pharma, IT, financial services, financial tech, FMCG, e-commerce are expected to lead this shift to pay for performance concept. Earlier, you know, when companies like TCS come for campus recruitment, they used to directly recruit our students with 9.0 up and above CGPA. Today, TCS has sent a note that, you know, we are now no longer going to go according to your grades because you are not going to conduct exams. You're averaging the students' performance for the last three semesters and then declaring the results. And everyone from degree colleges are passed without examinations. So we will conduct our own examination and our filtering process will be much tougher this time. So let us see how this is going to impact the pay structure realignment or the job cuts or the leadership and technology for providing direction, managing technology teams, connecting the dots, encouraging remote working possibility, and so on. So TCS and Twitter has initiated permanent work from home solutions. they are no longer, they feel that, you know, 40% of their bills are power bills, 35 to 40% are electricity bills. And then the real estate rents of having huge offices and maintaining those offices, also the Wi-Fi connectivity and the amounts they spend on internet bandwidth, also the providing the tea, coffee or hospitality services to the employees and freebies at workplace, you know, it is costing them very heavily. Now they feel, they know the best cost cutting measure is to close down the offices and request all the employees to work from home. So TCS and Twitter are the first companies to initiate this work from home concept. Many more companies are in the pipeline. So according to Yoga Tulsiani, Managing Director of XYAD Solutions, it will be a challenge as we have to prepare to the new tech of structures that work remotely, smaller cross-functional teams versus rigid top-down organizations. So occupations with highest suitability to work from home include computer professionals, directors and general managers who also require minimal human proximity in executing their jobs. Companies small to large across different industries have migrated their employees to the new remote work environment. He revealed that already 30% of the there is increase in performance for employees working from home because they are able to enjoy the time with the family, you know, share lunch with family, breakfast with family, you know, help the wife in the household chores, or you know, attend to their parents. So there is high level of motivation, in fact, in working from home. That is the positive aspect. And let us see what is happening next. Coming to the income and the consumption, stimulating demand and reaching consumers. A report by Microsoft and owned LinkedIn indicates that 25% of the Indian workforce has reported a decrease in their incomes. 39% reported a dip in personal savings and opportunities. If you see the middle class and the lower middle class, their disposable incomes are low and they find it difficult to save these days. But when you see the upper middle class, we are not able to travel more and we have no time to shop in the malls. I mean, we cannot go out because to the malls. So our shopping spends have come down zero. And we are only cooking at home, no Swiggy, no Uber Eats and so on. So there is a surge in demand. There's a fall in exports and imports, supply chain revitalization, consumer shopping and home delivery and shift to safe retailing. So, you know, I remember, you know, when we purchased a rice bag this month from a local merchant, my daughter was asking, do you have Google Pay? And the merchant has it. So we just transferred the money on Google Pay. Same is the case with provisions because we don't want to use currency. We don't want to use the ATMs. ATMs are the, you know, places where drastically there is going to be COVID spread. So when you are using an ATM, all of you must make sure that you carry a sanitizer and you know, first sanitize your hands, then withdraw money, come out, then again sanitize and then take your two-wheeler or four-wheeler home. So consumer shopping, home delivery, they need to shift to safe retailing. Coming to the functional side of production and operations, let us see what is taking place. The challenges are losses during lockdown and how do we restart the factory work? Most of the factory works are completely disturbed. There are only rodents, that is rats and other insects running in the factories. Less workforce input shortages may pose a challenge to raise and maintain production. And during losses during lockdown, manufacturers can take stock of their factories after the lockdown is lifted. The safety of machines, the usability of raw materials, inventory of finished products, etc. There is no certainty about being able to execute pending orders straight away. And less workforce, you need to manage with 25% of the workforce and you have input problems. Imports will become cheap due to low global demand. You know, you might have heard that, you know, barrels of oil because of the piled up inventory storage costs. Were oil companies were willing to give it free of cost from countries like Iran and Middle East. You know, they didn't have storage space. So they wanted to dispose of the oil, crude oil, free of cost to countries like India. But do we have the storage space? That is also a big problem in India. So this is the situation today. So this is the manufacturing. Imports will become cheap while companies depending on imports will do better. Dependent on local inputs may face a short shortage and problems. For them, identifying supply side problems like capacity, packaging, transportation, price volatility, these are all the challenges they are going to face. And what kind of strategies each company is going to evolve depends upon the company itself, depends upon its domain. Because many online platforms are picking up, many mobile service companies are picking up. And you know, Amazon, companies like Amazon have already announced for 60,000 jobs. Maybe some of you may be recruited by Amazon. But you know, some of the manufacturing companies are on the verge of close down. So how are they going to sustain, especially the small and you know, micro industries? So that is the problem with the production and operations. And next is the finance related. Consumer companies should carefully assess their liquidity positions, potential options to invest, borrow, or liquidate. Among companies with a sourcing back-end link to the agriculture or MSME, you know, small, micro, small, and medium enterprise sectors, there's high dependency on cash for stock. The opportunity is that the situation provides opportunity to review all the overall CapEx, capital expenditure, and revenue budgets with more rigor. There is going to be strict cost control and internal audit control and assess current plan for collections and payment deferrals. So the support from government can positively help maintain cash flows at lower costs. Because government has been giving subsidies and announcing, you know, you might have seen Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman every day giving subsidies and freebies to several sectors in the country to keep the system running. So next is the sector wise. Let us see sector wise how the situation is going to be. What are the sectors that are badly affected? The sectors that are badly affected are, you know, you can very well imagine the realty sector, the real estate. There are hardly any apartment bookings or, you know, sale of land or houses because people are worried about their future. They don't want to invest their monies. The hotel and tourism is very badly affected. Of course, in some of the countries like the Europe, you know, the GoPro cameras, virtual tourism has started. Aviation sector is very badly affected because, you know, they want to give space of two seats for every seat that is booked. That is, you know, the ticketing people can sell only one third of the tickets. Obviously, a flight ticket which is costing, say, in an economy airline of 2,500 rupees will now be, the customer has to pay about 7,500 rupees, now three times more. So aviation sector is very badly affected. Automobile sector is very badly affected. You will not believe in the entire April and May, not even a single car has been sold in India. So companies like Maruti Udyog have been focusing only on pre-used car segment. And also all the car companies, Honda, Hyundai, and all these companies, they are only calling their customers to leave their cars for service because they want to make money through servicing and selling of spare parts rather than selling cars. They are pretty sure that they cannot sell cars during this COVID crisis. The unaffected ones, as I told you, are the telecom sector. The healthcare, of course, always is booming whenever there is a pandemic. The healthcare sector, you might have seen the news where, you know, the corporate hospitals are charging 5-star rates for rooms with the ventilator facilities, the ICUs, intensive care units, and also the corporate hospitals. They are literally looting the common man, and the beds are not vacant in the government hospitals. So how do we manage? We need to manage sitting at home and taking care of ourselves. You know, you might have seen some videos from UK and other places where, you know, it's a simple paracetamol and more care at home, good diet and other things. You know, some families have fully recovered. Some VIPs have lost their life. Both ways we are seeing. So how is that we are going to manage? Let us see the retail and FMCG sector. Resale and strategies, you might have seen, you know, speed and agility will be the key drivers of success. and retailers will need to adapt to a faster, faster business, and both to navigate the crisis how and to plan for the next and beyond. They need to be very frugal with their finances. They need to be agile in their thinking. They need to spruce up their supply chains. They need to be tactful in talent management. I mean, what is the talent that is to be retained and what is the talent that is not immediately required? They need to be smart sizing their companies and effective in customer retention, responsible in regulatory and legal compliance. You might have seen almost all the FMCG giants, Johnson & Johnson, or Procter & Gamble, or Hindustan Unilever India Limited, donating millions of tons of sanitizers, disinfectants to hospitals. There's beyond their CSR budget, corporate social responsibility budget is 2%. But many of the companies during the crisis have come forward and they have been very supportive to the government institutions to take care of the public systems. And all of them are focusing more on, liquid soaps or sanitizers or, masks or producing disinfectants, things like that, which are the need of the hour. So a little bit of product pruning is taking place. Coming to the realities, they told you, Hira, who is the president of National Real Estate Developers Association Council in Mumbai, he says the losses have already crossed 1 lakh crore. I think it should be at least 3 lakh crore by now. Every month it is 1 lakh crore, it is reported. And developers, they want lower prices, deferred payment plans, price guarantees, free corona insurance, and so on. And the RERA, Real Estate Regulatory Authority, also has come forward with some special guidelines. If a customer has booked an apartment, is not able to repay, the builder has a responsibility to refund the entire amount without any charge. Number one. Number two is, the customer should give 9 months of additional time after booking the apartment, not as per the agreement. Beyond the agreement, he has to give 9 months of additional time for the builder to complete the project. Both ways, they have made some kind of, adjustments and some kind of, to keep this business rolling. The RERA has given some very good guidelines. So Knight Frank India survey found that in the next 6 months will be one of the worst phases in terms of new supply additions across major office markets in the country. Both leasing and rental properties will have low activity, and employees who lost their jobs, in fact, the government of India has been insisting that, house owners should not insist upon a rental payment. So employees who lost their jobs are given salary cuts, may fail to pay the installments in due time. Those having pending projects will be able to survive, while those planning new projects may have to wait for at least one more year. So post the pandemic, the delays is in ongoing projects may range from 3 months to depending upon the stage of the project and location. So there is clearly 20% reduction in the prices of luxury housing, 5% in the mid segment. Deferred payment plans of 10:90 plan, where the buyer may have to pay only 10% to book an apartment and 90% while taking the key. This kind of flexibility has come. And price guarantee means that if a house is worth 1 crore and if the prices were to come down in a few months or the buyer were to lose his job, the developer buys back the house and also offers 6% interest on the amount he has already taken as advance. So corona-free insurance is another freebie that they have got to get. So, excuse me. So coming to the hospitality and tourism sector, according to KPMG Feet Maverick, which is a consultancy, US-based consultancy firm, the Indian tourism and hospitality industry has potential job loss of 38 million, which is 70% of the total workforce due to COVID. It is projected to book a revenue loss of 1.25 trillion. In the calendar year 2020. The figure corresponds to 40% decline in revenue over calendar year 2019. The impact on the inbound and outbound passengers is expected to be more severe in the next couple of quarters. However, our Prime Minister sees some opportunities for revival many of the state governments also, like even the government of Andhra Pradesh, UP, and all these Kerala, Delhi, Tamil Nadu, they are also trying to attract foreign tourists despite, and they are eager to start the tourist activity because medicine has been announced now by Hetero Drugs and you know all these companies. Compared to Italy, Spain, France, and UK, India is far less affected. I will say, you know, compared to US now, far less affected by COVID-19, and our mortality rate is still 1.5%. So we can hope for a better tourism. Next, let's see what is the next sector. Next sector is the aviation sector. Aviation sector is hit by huge losses, slow demand recovery, and heavy fixed costs, thin margins due to competition. This is an opportunity for the structural reforms and government support. There is an opportunity for those who survive. For example, Virgin Australia and Virgin Mauritius have already closed. The surviving ones, they are on the lookout for merging with each other so that, you know, they become stronger and synergies can be worked out. I'm trying to rush a little faster because, you know, we already started a little late. I didn't know that there's a commerce seminar going on, and I was waiting from 4 o'clock for the my talk to start. Hope Mazhar will give me another 5 to 10 minutes to wind up. So coming to the financial services sector, post COVID-19, the government will be a key player in the financial services. Already, you know, you might have seen the banking mergers taking place and many scams that have taken place. The Punjab National Bank, PNB scam, the other bank scams, and also, you know, the scams in the housing sector and so on. So the government obviously is a key player for bank mergers, which it felt that is a risk absorber. And there will be a major shift in precautionary savings and aversion of households. People don't want to spend on luxury items. If, for example, if you want to replace your fridge, you don't do it now. And if you want to buy jewelry, you're not going to buy it now. You might have seen the advertisements of companies, you know, jewelry retailers like Lalita Jewelry saying that stay safe, don't buy jewelry. You know, negative marketing they are doing because they are concerned about the people living than buying jewelry. This increase, this could lead to flow of savings into bank deposits, and the deposits may pick up, and the household's propensity to borrow to spend will diminish. People will not go for personal loans or housing loans or, you know, any kind of loans, PF loans or things like that, because they will be very cautious about the money they have. So retail bankers could end up with a bounty of deposits, but with limited demand for loans. That is also a kind of positive projection that we can see. Coming to the telecom services, work from home and social distancing helped boost data usage by 10 to 15% in the home broadband and mobile space in India. Also, the bundled plans that offer long-term recharges achieved very good revenues during COVID. This is one sector where students should think of getting into jobs, because telecom sector and you know, mobile service providers, the business is picking up drastically. On the flip side, the demand for entry-level smartphones will decline because the big fish will eat away the small. The big fish like the Reliance, Airtel, Aircel and so on, you know, they will eat away the small fish. Even if the situation stabilizes by the mid-year, the people may hold off purchasing until the festive seasons. Next. Is the healthcare. India committed to spend about 10,000 crores to encourage domestic manufacturing. There's a near-term risk to the healthcare business, as outpatients' visits are increasing and elective procedures are obviously postponed. The loss is offset by benefits from COVID testing. COVID testing is increasing. Then insurance, the motor insurance is zeroed for the last 3 months because no vehicles are purchased, but health insurance, life insurance, many takers are there. So IRDAI advises all life insurers, that means the insuring companies, to cover COVID cases and accept coronavirus claims. Life insurances, insurers are selling more of protection policies, and there is less dependence on ULIPs, unit linked insurance plans, so that the product mix is more balanced now. So that is about it. So let us wind up the session by just looking into these videos. with the hope that the situation will improve. This is this an understanding of COVID requires a comprehensive. Are you able to watch? You have seen this story of six blind men and the elephant. Unless we have a clear understanding of all the sectors, all domains, all dimensions, all the strengths, all the opportunities, we will not be able to have a grand plan, business plan during the COVID crisis or post-COVID. So let us hope that the business is going to pick up. Let's see this last video and wind up the session.
Good evening to all. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Hope you could watch the videos fully, and we are very optimistic people. You know, we are management students, so we will take every problem, consider every problem an opportunity, and go ahead in building our careers. I should tell you something of interest in this context. In our university, we have been planning a series of webinars from executives from across the world. And I have been facilitating the students to conduct this. And we have already conducted about 6 events, and my students at the back end have been helping me out. I think one of the students who's helping me out is also there among the participants today, Mr. PVM Kashyap. He's from your Vijayawada. I have a student sitting at Bihar, another at Kerala, another at Pondicherry, and Kashyap, and a couple of students in Andhra Pradesh helping me. And these children have been doing it out of their own enthusiasm and academic interest. And suddenly Indian Institute of Management Bangalore sends us a letter that they want students to work at the back end for their executive development programs and webinars. And they are going to be paid 35,000 rupees. So, I'm very pretty sure I'm going to make a recommendation of these students who have been supporting me at the back end in preparing the PowerPoints, in preparing the brochures, in putting up the spotlight, and in sharing slides, and also reading out the questions and answers in the chat box and other things. And they are already experienced in conducting the events. So we try to convert every problem into an opportunity. I have a student of mine who has a welding shop here in Pondicherry, who started making sanitizer dispensers in the first week of COVID itself. So converting every problem into an opportunity is the challenge of the day. And I wish you all the best. I also request all the students of final semester number 2 and focus on those sectors which are growing to get into jobs and build a brilliant future. Wish you all the best. Any questions, you are free to ask me, or should I look at the chat box? You're eager to. So we are in the last hour of the day, so I'm sure you will all be tired. Someone is eager to give the vote of thanks. Any questions, students? No questions? Okay. Hope my voice was audible and understandable. Yeah. Okay. Dr. Mazhar, where are you? The host should unmute the speaker who want to deliver vote of thanks, please.
Wait, madam. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for your valuable information. And now I request Monica, first MBA students, will give the vote of thanks.
Good evening, all. I am Monica, pursuing first MBA. Consider the meet as honor and privilege to extend the vote of thanks. Today, I take the opportunity to put all my gratitude into words. On behalf of management and department, I would like to thank our honored speaker, Professor Lalita Ramakrishnan, Madam, for taking precious time out and giving a webinar on strategic management to us. Thank you, ma'am. I particularly thank our speaker, where she mentioned the need for attracting FDI, serious approach to Make in India and development of smart rural hubs in this seminar. The way in which she explained the subject was extraordinary. My heartfelt thanks goes to our secretary, sir, P. Srinivas, and principal, sir, Dr. V. Narayan Rao, for providing the opportunity to organize this webinar. Next, I would like to convey my thanks to our director, S. Venkatesh, sir, for this supporting in organizing this webinar. I would like to thank the flagship of our department, Dr. Mazharunnisa, ma'am, director and head of the KBN School of Management Studies, who took initiative in conducting fruitful webinars. I would like to acknowledge the organizing team and other faculty members for joining this webinar. My special thank you to the science department support in the team of technical arrangement. At last, I would like to thank all the participants of this webinar who made this a great success. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, Monica.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Ma'am, I'm Sailesha, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Mazhar madam has network problem, ma'am.
Okay. No issues.
Shall I leave the session, madam? Shall we leave this?
Yes, please. Wish you all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Happy day.
Thank you, ma'am.
Stay safe. Stay at home. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Students, you can leave the session.